you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
I've heard it. You've heard it. It's time for a new beginning. Time to start a fresh page or paint a new picture with our life. Sounds great in theory, but it can seem impossible. Life is messy. The lines have gotten blurred. Maybe we just don't know where to start. We look at the canvas of our lives and see mistake after mistake after mistake. It's overwhelming. When I look at my life with these messy lines and scribbles, it makes me think, is this as good as it gets? There's no eraser that can make this life make sense. But what if? What if there was someone that could make sense of our mess? They could take all our scribbles, all our mistakes, all our missed opportunities, and make them into a masterpiece. And then I remember, there is Jesus. He gives us a new life. Every day is new. Every day is a blank canvas full of possibility and promise. He takes our canvases, our lives that have been filled up with shortcomings, secrets, tragedies, and embarrassments, and he helps them make sense. When I look at the canvas of my life and I see nothing but disorder and chaos, I have to remember this. God is not a God of disorder. He's a God of peace. And you know what? He wants to take my hand and bring peace to the canvas of my life. So as we seek to make our mark, let us give God all our scribbles, all our mistakes, all our hurts, and trust that He will turn our messy lives into a masterpiece. His masterpiece.
This week has been interesting because I really feel like God has been showing us the way forward. I wish I could share everything that's in my heart today, but I can't. Because sometimes it's just not the right time to share as we're working through what God is trying to show us. But let me just say, what God showed us this week, I'm not going to say if it comes to pass, I'm going to say when it comes to pass. My goodness me. Just hold in there, Destiny Church. God is about to do something incredible in our lives that we have been believing for, belonging for, we are hanging on to. And you know, there will be every demon in hell trying to stop it, and there will be all hell break loose against what's going to happen. So we need to hang in there. We need to hold on to our faith. We need to believe that these are the greatest days of our lives, that God is going to do something this year which He's never done before. We are going to go way beyond, way beyond. I'm telling you, it's exciting. Exciting. Oh my goodness, I'm holding myself back. Hold back. So our key scripture for this series is Ephesians 2, verse 10, where it says, "For we are God's masterpiece." We are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things He planned for us long ago. He's making us into a masterpiece because He has a master plan for our lives. So last week I reminded you that you're an original, one of a kind. Turn to the person next to you and say, "You are one of a kind." Now, don't say it with that kind of attitude. Now, you are just one of a kind. There are no duplicates, just originals, no copies. And God made you to be you. So be you. Turn to the person next to you and say, "Be you." Now say, because I like you. You see, you are needed. You're needed in the church, you're needed in the community, you're needed in the world, you're needed by God. If you weren't needed by God, he wouldn't have put you here. You are important to what God is doing in the world today. You have a role, whether you believe it, feel it, think it. That's not the important thing. It's what God says that's important. And his word says that we have an important role in what he wants to do in the world. Because it says we were created so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. I was just thinking I need to grow my hair at the back, not keep getting it cut short. Because I'm feeling a breeze coming from the door. The fire exit has like an inch of, you know, gap under it. I'm feeling the breeze. It's coming up my neck here. Wear a scarf in church soon. If there was a plan we were created to fulfill, there was a purpose we were created for. Yes. No, we're not going to get one of those little things that we used to put by the door to stop the drafts coming through. The snake. Anybody have a snake? Yes. Anybody still got a snake? We need to pray for you. It's 2016. There are other inventions. Yeah, but it's not like the old snake. The old snake still works well. No matter how we feel, no matter what we think, no matter what others say, just like that £10 note that I used as an illustration last week, whether we're screwed up, dropped, or trampled in the ground by the decisions we made or the circumstances we face, God still loves us and values us, dirty or clean, screwed up, or finely creased. God still loves us. He still values us. Your value has not dropped. Your value has not dropped just because you fell. Oh, that was good, God. I can't take credit for that. I want in my notes. Not that I could take credit for anything that's in my notes, but that was good. Your value hasn't dropped because you fell. You are still his masterpiece. And the messy lines become a feature behind our success rather than a factor of our failure. Because messages come out of mess, ministry comes out of misery, mission comes out of mistakes, and mercy comes out of mayhem. And just like that jigsaw we were talking about last week, we need to see the bigger picture, not just the little piece. We focus too much on the little piece at the time rather than the bigger picture in time. And we will never see the picture from the piece, but we will always see the piece from the picture. It will all make sense in time when we see it put together. Do you see that God is putting things together? God is working in every part of our lives, good, bad, and ugly, to carry out his purpose. The mess is being used for the masterpiece. Have you ever thought about the fact that when you look closely at the Old Testament, you repeatedly see that the featured people of the Bible all had prominent dysfunction in their lives? This is not the exception. It's the norm. They really were a dysfunctional bunch. And we talk about the great lives, the great Bible characters. But it amazes me just how many of those great lives were actually lived by damaged people, right, who were in one way or another messed up. Think about it. Let's start at the very beginning, because it's a very good place to start. I can't carry on. Adam was a blame shifter who couldn't resist peer pressure. Eve couldn't control her appetite and potentially had the first eating disorder. Cain, not this Cain, murdered his own brother. I'm sure this Cain's probably thought about it once or twice, but Noah was a drunk who slept in the nude. Adam lied about his wife being his sister and then let other men walk off with her on two separate occasions. Sarah let her husband sleep with another woman and then blamed him and hated her. Lot, he had a serious problem with choosing the wrong company. Isaac talked his wife into concealing their marriage. Rebecca, the first mail order bride, turned out to be a manipulating wife. Jacob was essentially a compulsive deceiver. Rachel was a nomadic kleptomaniac. It gets worse. Reuben was a bit of a pervert who slept with his father's concubine. No, that's not an animal, by the way. Moses had a very serious problem with his anger. Miriam had a greed for power. Eli was a hopelessly incapable father who lost his sons to immorality. Saul was a psychotic with manic bursts of anger, episodes of deep depression, and traces of paranoia. David concealed his adultery with a murder. And Solomon, he topped it all. He was potentially the world's greatest sex addict with 1,000 sexual partners.
Wow.
I just went, wow. Okay, so we look pretty angelic.
Yeah.
Up to that bunch, right? I mean, maybe we're not that bad after all. I don't know about you, but I find that trend going through all those characters, and we could go into the New Testament. We didn't even get there. We didn't even cover every character of the Old Testament. We just took a pretty large selection, but that wasn't everybody. I find that somewhat comforting. Not because I want to use it or whether we should use it as a license to sin or justification for wrongdoing, but as a reassurance that we're not alone in navigating the challenges and temptations of life. Right. There are a group of people that went before us that we look up to that also struggled with those temptations and also struggled with those challenges.
Yeah.
And that when we get it so horribly wrong, God still works so incredibly right. Because the amazing thing is that God still uses them to do great things for him. Each one had a purpose. Each one was used for a purpose. Each one you could say was used on purpose. He took the good, the bad, and the ugly of their lives. And he used it. He's working, as we saw in the recap, all things together for good. Even our mistakes. I know you think, well, how could I, you know, how could God use the mistakes that I've made to actually fulfill the purpose in my life to reach other people, to be the person that God's called me to. Oh, you'd be amazed. He is an absolute specialist at taking the worst and making it into the best.
Yeah.
I see that I'm going to have to convince you more this morning. So what can we learn from these examples? Well, I had 5 points. I would doubt that I'm going to get beyond point two today. In fact, I'm just going to pace myself over these next 2 weeks. So we'll do two, whatever time it is. We might end early today. I might get through them mighty quick and surprise you all. But even if I don't, we're just going to do two because I want you to take this in. And I feel like the first one is really important, one that we need to grab hold of. I'm quite excited about sharing this with you today. So I hope you're excited about receiving it.
Amen.
Here's one of the things that we can learn, because there's a lot to consider when you think about how messed up they were, but how God was still able to use each one of them. Number one, God doesn't want mess concealed because of calling revealed. God could have concealed their mess, but he chose to reveal their flaws. Wouldn't we read a different Bible if he concealed their mess? We know about their flaws because God told us about them. I couldn't go through that list and tell you all their personal details had it not been in the Bible. Their story is told, warts and all. We know all those things about them, not because we know them personally, but because God knows them personally and chose to use those things to help us, to help other people. Amen. It's like he was purposely showing a watching world that to be great doesn't require us being perfect. Let's get that into our minds today, that we don't need to be perfect to be great. Actually, we don't need to be perfect to be used by God. So if you've been convinced that you are over because you made that one mistake, which was the mistake of all mistakes, I want you to know that someone sat next to you today also believed that about their mistake, but they're still going. So if they're still going, you keep going, because there is no mistake that's beyond the work of the cross and the blood of Jesus. It's amazing how the devil gets away with so much in our minds, because he convinces us we're the only ones that have made that mistake. We're the only ones that have gone there and thought. We're the only ones that have done something. We're the only ones that have said something. And when we start to share with one another, because his ploy is that we will stay quiet because we feel ashamed. We don't want people to know what we're really thinking. Right now, you are praying that God doesn't reveal to me what you're actually thinking. I've been in these meetings when there's been the prophetic working. And God starts to tell someone all about us. And you sit there in fear and trepidation that all your personal details are going to come out. You know, God's not about to expose that to the world. But he does want you to reveal the mess that you've been in. I'm getting a bit ahead of myself, so I need to come back. We need to understand that to be great doesn't require us being perfect. Because life is not picture perfect for anybody. And the problem when the world sees a church that they think is trying to be perfect, they disconnect. Because they think it's okay for you because you've got it all together, but it's not okay for me because I'm in a mess. What we've got to show them is that we're the same as them. We've just found the answer. We've just found the solution. We've just found Jesus. And he is the one who will take our mess and make it into a masterpiece. Just because he's creating a masterpiece doesn't mean it's picture perfect. Because a masterpiece, I looked up the definition of masterpiece, means a work of extraordinary skill. Extraordinary skill. Not a picture of impeccable perfection. And the skill is found in God's ability to take a messed up life and make it into a message of hope. Not in our capability to live a blameless existence and make it into a picture of perfection. We are trying to do what God is doing. We try to take into our hands what God is trying to do. So we try and make everything right when he's saying, I'm the only one who can make it right. I'm the only one who can take your mess and make it into a masterpiece. So stop trying to do it yourself. Stop giving yourself a hard time. Stop having those days when you think, you know what, God is never going to use me again. I'm never going to be able to do the great things that people spoke over my life years ago because I have messed up. Well, I've got news for you. The one who hung on the cross took your mess. Yeah. and is making it into a masterpiece. And it's because of him that you can have hope for a better day. You're not over. You are not over. And so the challenge to us is don't conceal the mess. Let God unseal the message and reveal the purpose. Because we can really struggle with authenticity. And the real temptation to misrepresent ourselves because of real pressure to conceal ourselves. We try and conceal ourselves. We do it by wearing a mask. We have a Sunday mask. We have our Sunday mask. And we know how to be around other believers. We wear the believer's mask. What we want others to see rather than what God wants others to know. It's going to get a bit challenging in the next 30 seconds. Hold on to your seats or your neighbor's leg. God wants others to see him working in you and through you, but the only way that they will see him is if they first see you. Then they will see the transformation of you becoming more like him. But if they don't see you, how will they see him? They've got to see that you are just like them to show them that God can work in them just like he's worked in you. That you are a work in progress. You haven't got there and you won't get there in this life. You are not going to be perfect in this life, so stop trying to be. Let God keep working on your life and make the mess the masterpiece. We will be perfect when we get to heaven, but not before. So let's help messed up people understand there is hope. That they too can go through this incredible transformation, but let them see you. Expose yourself. Now, don't take that literally. Take it in context with what I'm saying today. We know what happened to Noah. Anyway, we need to show other people that we have been messed up, are messed up, and will be messed up. That actually we make mistakes. We do things that are unwise, foolish. We've made decisions that have led us to a place which we prefer not to talk about. But God is saying, please talk about it. Please let others know what your weaknesses have been. The Apostle Paul made a priority of trying to speak about his weakness. Because he said, when I show my weaknesses, I can show God's strength. Because it's only because God is working through me and in me that I'm able to be who I am. He didn't talk about his strengths. He didn't talk about how great he was. I read something this week about a church, and it was all about how great they were. And I'm like, when we start talking about how great we are, it's not about not having confidence, but let's not get arrogant. Let's not talk about, let's just say, by God's grace, I am who I am. By God's grace, this church is where it's at. Not because of anything that I can do or I've done or I will do. It's because of him. It's his church. It's his work in us that's making us who we are. I've made a whole stack of stupid decisions throughout the years. I've done some really stupid things. I've done some really foolish things. But praise God, he's still working on the mess and turning it into a masterpiece despite what I've done, despite what you've done, and he will keep doing it too. God is hope because I was hopeless. I was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I can see. And it's all about the amazing grace that I discovered in my life that the Lord Jesus gave me through his death on the cross and his resurrection. God wants the same for us. He doesn't want us defined by our mistakes and our mess. He wants us defined by our calling and what he says about us. He is going to use every scenario to turn it around and make you into the person that he created you to be. Warts and all, mess and all, it doesn't matter what you did. It's all about what he did on that cross. It's all about what he's done.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.